seated. There was told a story of Alexander the Great. He was riding in his coach in Macedonia. And outside, approaching him was a man who was destitute. And he reached and cried out to the king. And the king reached into a box there in the chariot, a handful of gold coins, and threw them to the destitute beggar. Instantly, the chariot driver said to him, "Why, copper coins would have been good enough for this beggar." And Alexander the Great turned to the driver and said, "Of course they would. But gold coins was the desire of the giver." Extravagant giving. Extravagant generosity. Ed loved his Ford Fusion. It was the first one the year that that model came out, and he treated it better than he treated his kids. Next door to him was Miss Jane. And Miss Jane's car was left to her by her husband, who'd been deceased for several years. Most Saturdays, Ed was a shade tree mechanic trying to fix Miss Jane's car. It broke down often. And one particular day, Ed was working on Miss Jane's car. He looked down at the engine, and he thought to himself, "You know what? I can handle this car a whole lot better than Miss Jane could if it ever broke down when she was out on the road." And so he put down his tool that he was working on the car with. He went over to his house. He went in his bedroom, and he looked at his dresser, and he stared at the car keys on his dresser. And then he took his car keys and he went out and he got in his Ford Fusion and he cranked it up and he backed it out of the driveway and he turned into the street and he drove 40 feet. He turned left into Miss Jane's driveway. He drove up into the driveway, got out of the car, walked into the house and said, "Miss Jane, these are your car keys and from now on, this is the car you'll be driving. No questions asked, this is your car." Crazy. There was a third grade class, and Ronnie was a member of the third grade class. Ronnie went to the hospital, and the doctor says to Ronnie's parents, "Your son has cancer. We have to take him to the hospital in Memphis." And so Ronnie went to the hospital in Memphis, and he was treated for his cancer. And his friends in his class were concerned about him. In fact, his teacher was very concerned, and they wanted to do something for Ronnie. So they sent him cards, and they baked him cookies, and they stayed in touch with Ronnie while he was in the hospital. But Ronnie, they got the word that Ronnie was coming back to the school, and the teacher was very concerned about Ronnie and how he was going to be received because all his hair had fallen out while he was taking treatment. And the kids thought about what they might could do for Ronnie, but it was Buster. Buster was the little boy that talked too much and was always busy. There's a Buster in every class, isn't that right, teachers? Buster raised his hand and he said, "Miss Smith," he said, "I know what we need to do." And so he told Miss Smith. Everybody laughed, but Miss Smith started tearing up. And so on Monday when Ronnie came to class with his bald head, he walked into class and every little boy in the class had shaved his head. Generosity. Sharing. S-H-A-R-I-N-G. Jesus understood sharing. He experienced it a lot. He shared himself in so many different ways. And one day a little boy said, "Here, you can have my lunch." Y'all remember that story? And it so happened that the week of Holy Week, which we call Holy Week, he was in Bethany. He liked to go to Bethany. That's where Mary and Martha lived. And their brother, you remember him, Lazarus? And they cooked good. And Jesus liked the fellowship. And he would take, the problem with Jesus, you know what the problem with Jesus was? He would eat with anybody. And that made some people really ticked off, because they wouldn't eat with those folks, but Jesus did. So he goes to the house of a guy who had leprosy. I guess he was cured. You know, that's pretty bad stuff. And while they were there, we don't know how many people were there, but there were some folks there. This lady walks in. It's kind of weird, kind of strange. And she walks in with some kind of piece of a container, a jar, we're told. And I don't know what she does to break it open, but it says that she broke it open and she started pouring it on Jesus' hair. Now, I've been to some nice dinner parties. That would freak me out if that happened to me, you know? It would freak Curry out even more, y'all know? And a woman started washing his hair. And naturally, people were uncomfortable. I mean, you just don't do that sort of thing. Some said, we don't know who, but some said, well, why did she do that? As expensive as that is, I mean, that could have been sold. That could have been sold and given to the poor. Why? That's enough. 300 denarii, that was one laborer's wages for a year. We talk about more than Chanel number 5, ladies. And they just stared at her. They scoffed at her. And I don't know. They were all kind of stretched out. You know, they didn't sit at the table like we do. They lounged when they ate. And they went on and went on and went on. And what was even more interesting is that this host, he must have been busy, or somebody was busy, because when Jesus showed up, the thing they did back then was that they were dusty roads, and people wore, they didn't wear sandals. The rich people wore sandals. Other people were bare. You washed people's feet. Instead of saying, how you doing, come over here and wash your feet. That guy forgot to wash Jesus' feet. And so Jesus said, y'all need to hush. What this lady's done for me is a beautiful thing. She has sacrificed incredibly to bring this jar and to anoint my body for burial. They didn't understand. Mark's looking back and writing. Mark knows what's going to happen on Sunday. You know, they go with the donkey into town waving the palm branch. This is that close to Jesus' burial. And Mark tells this story preparing us all for that. About sacrifice and about generosity. And he said, from now on, wherever this story is told, this woman will be remembered. I have been given some incredible gifts in my lifetime. One, about 3 or 4 months ago, somebody walked in my office and said, the Lord told me to do this. And he or she pulled out several green Benjamin Franklins. That didn't happen to me very often. He said, I love you. Thank you. Just wanted to do this. I told you about that suit that I wore a couple of weeks ago. Folks gave me that suit because they love me. I bet people have given you things that you just treasure. I mean, I bet you've got stuff around your house that everything has a story about it. If you come in my study down the hallway back there, everything in there just about was given to me by somebody like you. Oh my goodness gracious. Generosity. You see, this lady broke the jar. She broke the jar. When have you broken the jar? When have you thought more about someone else and something else that really matters? And you really want to identify and be counted as someone who supports that? Or supports this person. We love our schools, don't we? I mean, just to step on campus, you better write a check. And if you want to go into one of those arenas where they play sports, you better write a big check. We love our schools. I know. I wrote a check. What else do you love? What would make you break the jar like this lady did? Don't you have enough stuff? I do. Except I want my patio to look really cool so that when y'all come over to my house, I can say, I got this, we made this counter, and it's got tile on it, and it's wooden, and I can put some stuff in here, and I can cook. I like stuff like that, y'all. I do. But I almost have enough. A couple of more things. And that's all right. It's all right. When you break your jar for something that matters and something that makes a difference in somebody else's life. Some of y'all may have heard this story. I checked it out ahead of time, but it's one of my favorite stories about breaking the jar. There was a church in the Midwest trying to raise some money to build a new building. They needed the space. They wanted to build it for children and their weekday program like we have. And by the way, if you've never been up here during the week, Monday or Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Stephanie does an incredible job meeting the needs and with her faculty and staff of children who have a special niche. Their mamas don't want them to be full-time daycare, but they can drop them off here. My great-nephew, Bo, comes. I wish he knew me better so I could go in and play with him, but when I stick my head in the door, he cries. This couple, Steve and Dana, were on the leadership team of the capital campaign for their church. And they got to telling their stories when they met with groups and they met with the leaders. See, 3 years prior to that, Steve and Dana had a 17-month-old. Well, they were hoping to have a baby. 3 months prior to that, they built their house and they were set. They had their dream house. And they wanted to tithe, but they couldn't. They just couldn't swing it. So they committed to pledging 7% of their income that year. And they promised that in 3 years, they would get to 10%. And they had, but they were tapped. I mean, they were tight. They really budgeted. It's kind of like my friends down in Meridian. They had really tapped. And so they wanted to do something for the campaign. They wanted to give a gift. But, I mean, they put pencil and pen to it, and they couldn't do it. And the leader of the group said, well, what do you really value in your life? What would make you break a jar? And they started praying about it. This was a young couple that they, by that time, they now had a 17-month-old baby. And, you know, I mean, they wanted to do that. And they started thinking. They said, they discovered, and they had conversation about this, and it didn't happen overnight. They really both decided that the most important thing in their life was their marriage. And she had an idea. Crazy. They went to the jeweler where 5 years earlier they had purchased their wedding bands. And they got their wedding bands appraised, $2,000, both rings. And they said, thank you. And they called their pastor, and they said, here's what we decided to do. And the pastor said, Steve, you got to tell your story in church. And so that Sunday, they told their story. That afternoon, the chairperson in the church who was in charge of the capital campaign called the pastor. And he said, my wife and I have been talking over lunch, and we want to give more to the campaign that we've set aside. In fact, we want the name of the jeweler because we'd like to go talk to him and buy back those rings and give it to Steve and Dana next Sunday when we have our commitment Sunday. Well, the chairman of the committee told a couple of other folks, and they told a couple of other folks, and they told a couple of other folks, and before the week was over with, there were T-shirts printed. Picture of two gold wedding bands interlocked. And the caption said, "I bought the rings." And that Sunday, people began to come down to the altar and lay their cards on the table. And the pastor asked Steve and Dana to come down to the altar, and he presented them with their wedding bands because they broke the jar. Alexander the Great said, "Copper coins weren't good enough. The king desires gold." Brothers and sisters, you and I are children of the king. And our king gave a king's ransom for us. I hope one day, if it's today, hallelujah. But I hope one day we can all break the jar. Because folks, that's what joy is about. Down in my heart. Let us pray. Lord, woo, you've been good to us. Oh, we got trials and tribulations, and some of us have had cancer and heart attacks, and some of us have got broken hearts from losses and griefs that are real. They're always with us. But thanks be, so are you. It's so easy to get stuff that we want. We just do it. Sometimes we pay for it later. May we give you, if not today, tomorrow or the next day, or in a few months, or maybe like Steve and Dana in 2 or 3 years, get to the place where we can give you our best and we can walk the aisle with joy, 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 joy down in our hearts. May we experience that, or at least a taste of that, today. In Jesus' name, amen.